We need somebody very creative to think about that. Maybe my civil engineer or some good biomechanics person, but it's a good question. So that is that was based on our early 1991 study then for accounting for trap closure. Well, trap closure has been studied by a number of people, but another process that is every bit as interesting is trap reopening. And so if we start with a trap that is closed and sealed, then the trap, what sort of changes cause the trap to open? And again, this is a cartoon, so obviously I can draw it any way I want. And in fact, I just transposed these figures. But in essence, the morphological changes in the trap between closing, which is illustrated up here, and reopening are very, very similar. So morphologically, closing and reopening are similar to each other. So we did the same thing again in this study that we did in the previous study. We measured those cells in the same way we calculated mean cell lengths. And we have, again, up here in the top region, not only the inner tissue growing, but also the outer tissue as well. And so the net effect of this is then going to be to cause this recurved part of the trap to disappear and for a bulge to form up here, beginning to open up the trap. If we go to the next stage, we see the same sorts of data that we've seen before. This growth down here will tend to begin to swing the lobes apart, so the lobes will begin to separate, and we have now a released stage. And then the last stage will be to bring this release trap to full open. And again, very active C compartment. Again, we have a very active B compartment on the outer part of the trap, and a very, very active compartment, very active tissue dynamics up here in the A compartment. And basically then, the effect of this is going to be to straighten this lobe out, not really this straight. Morphologically, they seem to be reverse of each other. However, the tissues and the tissue dynamics associated with closure and reopening are unique. They are not the same, and so they are wholly different events. We know what initiates closure. We don't know what initiates reopening. But reopening is probably also going to be triggered by a relatively distinct signal of some sort. And so the third part of this conclusion then is that I think we need to look at Venus flytrap as being an extremely wonderful model to look at an incredibly complex plant behavior. And I begin to wonder if how similar this is to other kinds of plant movement. Could Venus flytrap really be a model for understanding plant development or plant movement, not only in causing things to move from place to place or flowers to open, but also in development? And I've been sort of struck here as we've been talking about plants like Nepenthes. Well, I wanted to acknowledge some of the students that have done work for me on this project, or worked with me.
Fagenberg contained in the internal body of the plants, and no surface contains Fagenberg. We thought some bioactive substance may be involved in this memory. If some bioactive substance was secreted in the plant body by two stimuli, the memory can be interpreted by the accumulation of the secreted bioactive substance. However, no study has been reported on the chemical substance concerning the internal bioactive substance, which induced the closure of traps. The clones were cultured by tissue culture method using modified MS medium developed by Professor Kondo, a previous speaker. After the leaves were closed by the stimuli by the cutting, the reopening leaves were used for assay. One leaf each was placed in H2O in glass juice, in a biotolon at 27 degrees. The sample solution was carefully poured into the glass tube to attain appropriate concentration. The extract was filtered to remove residual leaves, and the filtrate was concentrated in vacuole. And then that was centrifuged at 10,000 Z, 20 minutes at 4 degrees. The leaf closing activity of all these fractions were checked by bioassay, and only this A-class fraction from the 10% methanol extract was bioactive at 20 grams per liter. And no organic layers showed bioactivity against the leaves. This result suggested the existence of two bioactive substances with different molecular weight. To confirm this, we carried out the separation of this aqueous layer by gel filtration chromatography. This result was consistent with the result from water filtration. Thus, two bioactive substances inducing leaf closure were contained in Dionaea. Next, we show the purification of the bioactive substance of the high molecular weight. The bioactive high molecular weight fraction was further purified by one more gel filtration chromatography. After examination of the separation condition, purification by a reverse phase HPLC using several columns ended in failure. The high molecular weight fraction, bioactive fraction, after gel filtration was then subjected to anion exchange column chromatography. After the purification by anion exchange column chromatography, we observed the proton NMR spectrum of the bioactive fraction, this one. Then we have obtained two bioactive fractions inducing leaf closure against the leaf of Dionaea. One is supposed to be an acidic polysaccharide containing some delphi sugars, this one. And the other is supposed to be a relatively low polar, small molecule. We have shown that they are contained in Dionaea some internal factor inducing the leaf closure. No bugs, insects, worms didn't feed on Dionaea while they preyed on small insects or worms. How do they defend themselves against these predators? Probably the thick cuticular layer on the surface of the plant prevents themselves from being preyed by these predators. However, we thought Dionaea also contains some poisonous compound to prevent them from being preyed. Thus, Dionaea accumulates a great deal of plumbagin in the plant body. And also, plumbagin was reported to have antifeeding and repellent activity. Thus, we saw that Dionaea stores a great deal of plumbagin to defend themselves from predators. In conclusion, we found that Dionaea had some internal bioactive substance which induced the closure of traps without stimuli. These bioactive substances would be clue for the interpretation of the memory observed in the movement of Dionaea on molecular level. And we found that Dionaea contains a great deal of plumbagin, which is known as antifeedant and repellent. Thus, Dionaea would defend themselves from predators such as animals, birds, or insects by virtue of these compounds. Thank you for attention.
We have to be optimistic that now we have the tools to go to the fundamentals, to the DNA, and to the way the different mechanisms fit together. And then, sooner or later, I think quite soon, we will understand it much better. So I think that by this we can conclude this interesting symposium. We have to thank the contributors, presenters of the interesting lectures. Thank them again for their presentations.